In our search for answers as to what the true age of our civilization actually is, we look at the historical records that have been translated for millennia. We assume the age that society and culture are around 5,000 years old, even though the evidence overwhelmingly suggests otherwise. To quote Graham Hancock, human history has become too much a matter of dogma, taught by professionals in ivory towers as though it's all fact. Actually, much of human history is up for grabs. The further back we go, the more that the history that's taught in the schools and universities begins to look like some kind of fairy story. This basically means that considering one person's line of belief, if that person armed with resources at their disposal goes on and searches for answers, especially during antiquity, then what that person finds will be interpreted based on what that individual may have already been educated to believe based on past closed-minded findings. And when this is reported in the country from which they came, then you are now faced with millions being fed this information as fact. Of these millions, a handful will go on to add to this preconceived notion, something along those lines anyway. Do you understand what we mean by this, guys? The structures we see in Egypt were assumed to have been built during the dynasty of the Egyptians, even though the dynastic Egyptians themselves tell us in hieroglyphs and papyrus that these structures were already in place at the time of the gods, thousands of years before the pharaohs. You can't help but wonder as to on what scale these lies have been manifested. Just wait to hear this. In 1993, the late lecturer and guide John Anthony West and the geologist Robert Schock presented a TV documentary challenging the conventional 4,500-year dating of the carving of the Sphinx. They contended that weathering on its body and the surrounding enclosure walls could only have been caused by prolonged rainfall between 12 and 10 thousands of years before the birth of Christ. Their documentary also suggested that the monument had been carved by an ancient advanced culture that appears to have spread across the globe, reaching Australia and Easter Island, and even proof they had contact with the ancient Irish inhabitants. It's mind-boggling to think that we have strayed so far from this knowledge, but at the same time, we now have a real feeling that for the first time in modern history, we are now hotly disputing just how old the Great Sphinx actually is, much to the dismay of Egyptologists and ancient history buffs the world over. Legend has it that at one time in history, the Sphinx was enchanted and could speak. The ancient Greeks said that it devoured all travelers who could not answer this riddle. What walks on four legs in the morning, two legs at noon, and three in the evening? The hero Oedipus gave the answer, man, and the Sphinx, enraged at receiving the right answer, leapt down from the precipice where it sat and was dashed to pieces. The ancient Egyptians called the Sphinx Hu or Hor-Im-Akhet, Horos of the Horizon, a name originally linking the Sphinx to the rising sun. On the dream stela, Thutmose IV refers to the pyramids of Hor-Im-Akhet, from which Selim Hassan deduced that the pharaoh considered the Sphinx to be older than the pyramids. Another Egyptian name for the Sphinx was Sheheb Ankh Atum, the living image of Atum. The name Sphinx used today is a Greek corruption of Sheheb Ankh. So the Sphinx names over the period of Egyptian civilization have meant father, terror, the horizon, Horos, Atum, a protective underworld deity, and a star-clustered hybrid beast. This assortment suggests many different ages and beliefs. The second snippet of text in the Book of Scrolls is copied from an even older scroll. Its scribe Heracat asked God to help me in my transcription of these ancient writings, that they may be a true record. They have been transcribed exactly as they are, and no thought or belief of mine has gone into them. If Heracat considered the writings ancient several thousand years ago when he transcribed them, the mind struggles to take in the age of these writings. The scroll tells how the people of the light came to Egypt from Ramukai of the Seven Cities, land of copper, led by the old bald-headed one. The strange snippet of text which could refer to the Sphinx appears at the end of this paragraph. There are writings which speak truly, but they are no longer with us. The arisen ones know the secrets of the lesser gods who are no more than these. The great scales weigh the soul by its appearance in the netherworld, and thus its place is appointed. Its virtues form its food, but no man eats the filth that is his. He who devours souls is but the dark cave of horror, which opens to receive dark souls into affinitive darkness. The Rakima watches in silence. Patiently it sits, waiting for the day of the destroyer. It will come in 100 generations, as is written in the great vault. The text then moves into a prophecy of global catastrophe. Enigmatic indeed, the two sentences at the end sound almost as if they have been tacked on to the preceding text. The Rakima watches in silence. Patiently it sits, waiting for the day of the destroyer. It will come in 100 generations, as is written in the great vault. Like the great guardian snippet, this portrays something that forever sits in silence, watching and waiting here. It waits for the day of the destroyer, while in the great guardian text, it awaits a day when he comes not. In this text, the something is linked to the weighing of souls and the underworld, which again suggests Anubis, that the great Sphinx originally was Anubis. So something that may just about be as old as time as we know it, and maybe even older, appears to have no direct references that we can guarantee is a reference to the Great Sphinx. But one thing is for sure, and that is the fact that these texts are not in relation to any other monument anywhere else on Earth. Why? Because nothing exists anywhere else on the Sphinx's great age or great standing. In fact, all other smaller Sphinx-like guardians found in the region are in fact copies of the Sphinx. Perhaps answers to what exactly the Sphinx once looked like can be found in the tomb of Tutankhamun, but then again, maybe not. What do you guys think of this anyway? This is part two in our mini Sphinx series, and based on the findings of Graham Hancock and many others over the past four decades, we recommend you go and check out the work of these people, and we will leave links to that in the description box below. As always, guys, comment below, and thank you so much for watching.